Today we have Professor Bill Cook, who is a CNO professor, talking about the traveling salesman problem with growing distances.
Okay, thanks. My course? Great. Hope you'll take my course next term. A beauty of the traveling salesman problem, it's so easy to state. You just drop some points and then compute the shortest word. The problem was originally stated for mathematicians by Carl Mayer.
So some of you might know the name Mayer from Mayer's theorem of graph theory or the Mayer sponge and fractals.
The problem he posed is there a better finite algorithm for the DSP? So in other words, can you find that optimal torque without explicitly checking all n factorial permutations? Of course, Menger's not the name normally associated with the problem. That's William Rowan Hamilton. Right? I mean, two or three false Hamiltonian circles. And I get it. I mean, Hamilton's a cool guy. He's got those Hopkernians. Makes music videos about him. Is there a better finite algorithm? I mean, it appears that in the same journal in 1931, from Felix in German, in 1931, the same journal issue as Kurt Kuzos, his first paper on unsighted buildings. Right? And it's not just a coincidence. You would have never heard of it. But due to those coming every week to Menger's math colloquium, where Menger eventually stated this problem. So where's Menger, in Google, is going right at the heart of logic. Let's go though. Menger is going after complexity. Right? Can you actually solve problems with a reasonable amount of resources, computational resources? So he posed the problem in 1930 and generated a lot of discussion, but the first major paper didn't appear until 20 years later by Julia Robinson. Now Robinson's name you might know, she was one of the three people who finally solved Hilbert's 10th problem. So you're very famous mathematician. He did this work at the Rand Corporation, which was a think tank in California, one year after getting her PhD, as a postdoc. Her thesis was actually on Gödel's side of the world. So her thesis was about proving theorems on and rationals are on the side of the world. So it's a little bit surprising that she's maybe coming back to the TSP, the Menger side of the world, but in this case, I think it's just a coincidence. While she's a postdoc at Rand, she's actually part of what's been called the most remarkable group of mathematicians ever assembled to work on optimization. So it's not surprising that she might be drawn to the traveling salesman problem, which is a central topic of optimizers. What I do find interesting, though, is that when she's coming at this from the point of pure mathematics point of view, as a logician, and yet when she sees the traveling salesman problem, she's not thinking what we currently think about it as an asymptotic problem. So she doesn't think about it as n goes off to infinity. She wants to find a method that will help in practical cases, like n equals 50, even n equals 10. She's really trying to take a practical viewpoint, which this I find quite remarkable. Somebody who's steeped in pure mathematics, this is their viewpoint. Now, what she does, what she accomplishes in this paper, is the development of an iterative method, not for solving a traveling salesman problem, but for solving a relaxed problem called the assignment problem, where you just assign one city to the next. So you end up covering the cities not just by one circuit, but by many circuits. She doesn't give an analysis of this, a worst case analysis of this. What she does is present a method that she argues is practical, so that it could be implementable for a 50-city problem. But the same model, the assignment problem, was studied the next decade further by von Neumann, the famous von Neumann, and Munkrees. Now you might know the name Munkrees from the topology book. It's the same guy. Still alive. I'm not von Neumann. What they both did is propose algorithms for the assignment problem, together with analysis shows that in the worst case, they're better than the impact story. Indeed, it was these two papers that gave the big push for the study of polynomial time algorithms. Right? Their analysis is they're running polynomial time algorithms. That's not for the TSP, that's for the assignment of the relaxed version. But for the TSP itself in 1962, the n factorial barriers finally broke by Bellman and also independently by Helden Cox. They both have the same algorithm. And it runs in n squared 2 to the n time, which is a lot better than n factorial, but it's reasonably large. Now, this remains today the best algorithm for the traveling salesman problem in the sense of worst case complexity. No one's been able to beat n squared 2 to the n. There's been many years with a simple algorithm, clever but simple, no improvements on this. But once they established this, breakthrough n factorial, the question then became, could you push this to a polynomial time balance, like what von Neumann and Munker said? And what was zone Jack Edmonds was in the middle. This is Jack Edmonds, this is Brock, actually, since they were on Glasgow Street. Let's go along Avondale, or ends on Glasgow. He's a big guy. Yes, that's a big rock. for several years, tried hard, following up his work on matching, to get a polynomial time TCP algorithm. He called those good algorithms. But after a few years, he becomes convinced that there just isn't one. So he makes the conjecture that there is no polynomial time algorithm. So these days, that conjecture would be that P is not equal to N. This is one of the great open questions in mathematics. And if you're interested in it, I can strongly recommend this BBC radio program with Timothy Dowers and Colba and Leslie Ann Goldberg. They give a very nice discussion, introduction. But let me say one more thing about Bellman and Helfgott. So they're the reigning complexity champions of the TSP. And you if you look at their original papers, they have detailed discussions about the computational side, not the analysis side. They have the analysis, but the analysis was there to back up their claim that this was applied work. Indeed, the Helicon paper has lots of computations on IBM hardware. So I think this is a really nice test of using theory to back up applicable work. But indeed, the traveling sales problem does come up in applications. I have a computer code in application called Contour. And I give it a website to any company that's willing to tell me how they're going to use it. All right, so that way, each week or so, I get another test application. So last year in the spring, I got an email from Jet.com, which is a competitor of Amazon. And their problem is that they take this wagon and human pushes it around the warehouse, and they pick up the stuff, and then they go back, put it into the boxes to mail out. So their problem was how to design these racks to the warehouse. And what they wrote is that using a Concord to find optimal tours was about 15% better than sort of the engineering S-shaped paths they were using. But more importantly, it was 3% better than their own heuristic algorithms were delivering. So I thought, now 3% might sound like a lot, but in this online marketing, you're trying to compete for every dollar. You know, you're going to only go to Jet.com if the prices are less than Amazon. So this was important. But I'm not much of a businessman. This was in the spring of 2016. In the fall of 2016, Jet.com is purchased by Walmart for $3.3 billion. And if you look at the press releases for this, this big price was due to their technology base. All right, so Jet.com got $3.3 billion, I got zip. but it's still a nice application. So a lot of the applications are this stuff, humans or machines moving around, but there's also many sequencing problems, like genetics or machine scheduling or data analysis. So the TSP does arise. So, I mean, you have a fun problem, it's got a cool name, it has lots of applications, what's not to look? And it has one more thing, that because it's so simple, it has a great track record for producing results of general applicability. So, many of the household names you know in discrete optimization, the applied side of discrete optimization, the cutting planes, branch and bounds, simulated annealing, they all come from TSP papers. They all come from TSP research. Foremost amongst these is the classic hit by Fancy, Faulkner, and Johnson that introduced the cutting plane. So Vashakwata and I call this the Big Bang of discrete optimization, because it
lay down results that, even today, the town might even think, certainly on the computational side. And it's a beautiful paper, I mean, like, for example, this abstract, there's no posture, just single thing. You might notice I stole that line for the abstract and stuff, something I've always wanted to do. What they do is they find a tour through 49 cities, but not just any tour. They prove that it's short as possible. I have to point out that that's something today that's widely believed to be impossible to do. So 2 years ago, 2015, certainly the most widely cited, widely publicized mass tour was about some guy from Michigan found a pretty good tour through the United States. Not an optimal tour, but it's published in newspapers across the world. And what they point out is that when you can't get the optimal tour, there's too many things to check. It's impossible. Well, it's not impossible. I mean, 50 years earlier, Nancy Fauci announced it did that. And I have to point out, not only did they solve the problem, they solved it by hand. Right? They found that tour by hand and proved that it was optimal by hand. So how did they do it? The main technique was linear programming. If you don't know linear programming, you should So linear programming, you know linear algebra is basically the study of Ax equal to b. Linear programming is the study of inequality, Ax greater than or equal to b. So that's the study of linear programming. So to put it in that setting, you can't talk about a graph, you have to have vectors. So you represent a tour as a 0-1 vector, where you have a 1, like in 2-4, you have a 1 if the edge is used in the tour, and a 0 if it's not used. So every tour gives you a 0-1 vector. Find the shortest tour, but that's optimizing a linear function over those vectors. So that's what you want to do. Unfortunately, there's a lot of vectors. There's a lot of tools. And so as a preliminary step, what you do is you have these vectors, you take the smallest convex set containing them, so you shrink wrap the points in the convex set. By a theorem of Minkowski at the turn of the last century, he shows that if you take such a convex hull, that's a solution set to a system of linear inequalities. Don't be worried about the details of the slide. This is basically the summary of the first half of CNO 55. So you still follow the TSP without the model. But all right, so if you take the convex hull, Minkowski says, well, that's a solution set to a system of linear inequalities. Optimizing for a polytope inequality is exactly what linear programming does, but it's a simplex method designed to solve. Now, the nice thing is, you want to optimize over these ones. These are the four vectors. You optimize over the convex hull, you can always get as an optimal solution one of the corners, just one of the original points. That means, in theory, you could model the trapping salesman problem, or any discrete optimization problem, as a linear programming model. The trouble is, for the trapping salesman problem, you don't actually know what the x less than Ax greater than or equal to B is. No, no, A or B. We know that they exist, but we don't know. Even like for 11 cities, it's unknown what the inequality is. But that didn't slow down Dancing Fulton and Johnson. They decide, well, they can still work this theory out, even if they just know a little bit about Ax most people. So let me describe how they do it. To start off, now this isn't necessary, but they did this just to sort of guide their method. They wanted to find out a good tour, so they made a physical model of the problem. So a piece of wood, put in nails, this is not surface, this is just some reproduction. They made a physical problem that they put nails for the city, tied a string, then used the string to trace out tours. That way in their units they found a tour that was named 699. They don't know it's optimal tour, but they're going to use that to guide them. So they want to set up a linear programming problem. They would love to get that full TSP polytope, but both they don't know it, and that's going to be a hell of a lot of inequalities. Instead, they get a simple model. All they do is say that the variables are bounded between 0 and 1. The tour vectors are 0 and 1, so they're trying to bound between 0 and 1. And for each city, or for each node, the sum of the variables hitting that node has to be exactly 2. Well, that's true of any tour, right? Any tour hits the city and leaves. All right, so every tour vector satisfies these inequalities. What they're going to do is find the optimal vector subject to those inequalities. And that's going to give us a bound on any tour. Any tour is a candidate solution. All right, so they feed that to the simplex method. The simplex method spits out an answer. It's unfortunately not a tour, right? Because it's allowed fractional variables. So the black ones have value 1, the red ones have value half. So simplex method doesn't lie, city either means two blacks, which is two, or one red, one black and two reds, which is two. Right, so simplex method doesn't lie. And it does something good for you. So the optimal solution here is 641. Now, every tour was a candidate solution, and this is the best solution. So we then know no tour can have value better than 641. All right, so that 699 tour is not too bad. Right, and then they can do more. I mean, so up here around Maine, you have this island. Now, any traveling salesman is going to have to visit that island at least once, go in and out. All right, so we can set up another linear inequality that says that what you have to use, some of the edges leaving an island, they have to be these two. But that's called a subtour inequality. You take any proper set of cities or city nodes, S, let delta of S be the edges that have one in S, the green ones, that have one in an S and one in not an S. Now you sum over the variables to delta of S, that should be these two. Just saying that long enough order that we cross at least twice. And not exactly twice, you might go in and out, at least twice. So for many, you take that as our cities, set of cities S. We have the subtour inequality, we sum up with the simplex method. Well, you see again, the simplex method doesn't lie. We now have two reds and one black, that's value two. We have to set at least two, so it handles it. And the good thing is now the LP value is 676. So now we know no tour can be better than 676, so the 699 tour is looking better. And we can continue because we have this island appeared in the middle of the country. So let me skip ahead and have seven steps of the method. We have an island, or in this case, it's not an island, but it's a set that'll get two reds leaving, only value one leaving. So we find sets that have value less than two, we add them, and resolve. And eventually we get to an LP solution that has value 697. So we have a tour value 699, and we know no tour can be better than 697. I mean, you're tempted to think, well, I just add a couple more subtour inequalities and we've been done, but if you start standing at this, you quickly realize a learning. So no matter what subset you pick, you have at least two leaving. But one way to check that, if you study that from flows, is you can find a flow of value 2 between any pair of points. That means that there's no cut. There's no set that has value less than 2. So you can't get any subtours. But remember when Minkowski told us that the convex hull of tours is a polyhull. And this point is not in the convex hull of tours, which is an LP solution. So there's some inequality that's satisfied by the tours, but not satisfied by the spectrum. Finding such an inequality is called a separation problem. But this point is not in our polyhull, we want to separate it. Dan 16 did this by just sort of ad hoc, but we'll do it in a more organized way. From work in the 1970s, led by Basha Kvatel, who you know might know from Kvatel Cuts, don't worry, Kvatel Cuts. And also Martin Groschel and Manfred Padberg, two of the giants in the PhD competition. The building block for what Kvatel uses is something that's called DOM, it's a simple structure. You have subsets, the thing of this is a Venn diagram. There are subsets A and B that are disjoint, and the union is not the full set of cities. That's called it out. Oh, I should point out this photograph is taken by the Adrian Bond, who's a famous graphic that most of his career here at Waterloo. And when I published a small PSP book, there was reviews, and one of the reviews before writer of Wired, she wrote that after seeing the picture, she always, you know, thought, well, they have stereotypes of massive being nerds, which, you know, we are. But said that those are the most serious badasses out there. Ever seen Kvatel. And Kvatel really liked it, even now this is 5 years later, I get an email from him, he always signs it Professor Badass. Alright, so back to his dominoes though. What's nice about a domino is you can add the three subtour inequalities together. One for the A union B, one for A, and one for B. The three subtour together cover the borders of the domino, that black portion of domino cover every border twice. So by dividing by two, what that says is that edges crossing the domino border, any tour, the edges crossing the domino border has to be these three. So a sum over all the variables crossing the border has to be these three. That's satisfied by every tour. So Professor Badass puts those together into a structure called the cone. So you have a set H and a set of disjoint dominoes. Now, the TMI refers to the union of the two sides of the trunk. These are called the teeth of the trunk. H is called the handle. Now, H could have other nodes down here besides those ones. There's, of course, probably ones in the dominoes, but there's other ones down here. The dominoes have non-empty intersection, a non-empty AB should both be non-empty. All right, so that's a domino. The inequality says that if you sum the border of the handle, so delta for the handle, plus delta for each tooth, K teeth, and K is off, that's important. That has to sum to be these 3K plus 1. Any tour satisfies that. And in the proof, making use of the fact that we already worked with dominoes is easy. Because this left-hand side, on the left-hand side, is dominated by, it's bigger than or equal to, the sum of the crossings over all the dominoes. Right? Because in delta H, you cross this border, and in the delta T, you're crossing those borders. So you're crossing all the borders of all the dominoes. So this left-hand side is greater than or equal to the sum of the dominoes. That's greater than or equal to 3k. Each one's greater than 3. Okay? That didn't give us anything. Every subgroup satisfies that. Every solution that satisfies subgroup satisfies that. But the important thing is that every tour hits any set an even number of times. If you pick any proper set of nodes, the tour goes in and out. So even. So each one of these numbers is even. So you're summing up an even number that's greater than or equal to 3k, which is an odd number. That's why it's greater than the 3k plus 1. It's even and bigger than equal to 3k, therefore bigger than equal to 3k plus 1. So it's a simple parity argument, but it's a great strengthening of subgroup inequalities. For example, in Danzig's problem, there's no violated subgroup inequalities, but it's easy to spot the cone. So the yellow set is the handle. It has three black edges leaving, so value 3. These are the teeth. Each one has two reds and one black, so value 2 leaving. So altogether, this has value 9, but the cone, in this case K3, the cone should be 3K plus 1, should be 10. That's violated. So that's exactly what we want. It separates that solution from the tours. So what we do is we add that cone, and then we find one more cone, and then we actually get a tour as an optimal solution. And that's not the problem. It actually turned out to be value 699, what they had in the beginning. So that, they didn't know that would be the case. Right, so this is pretty amazing, right? In 9 steps, there's billions and billions of inequalities. Yet in 9 steps, they found the right ones to solve the problem. Again, this is something that is reported to be impossible. And this is a big wide-reaching effect. For the DSP, this type of methodology is being used to solve geometric problems with tens of thousands of points. Big success. But there's still some basic algorithmic questions that remain open. So we don't know any of the components of the cutting thing method. It's called the cutting thing method because it's cutting off the points with these type of things. For many components of the cutting thing method, we don't really understand what's going on. So, for example, even the cone inequalities, which are the basic objects and very powerful, and yet we don't know how to solve the simple problem of the basic problem, given an LC solution, is there a cone that's violated at that point? So can we use the cone as a cutting plane? There's no time method for deciding that. So this was a project we decided to study for in a URA last winter with Sally, Quincy, and Shelley. So looking at the complexity of cones. So I'll just mention some computational results that came out as a consequence of that. So these results are all for what's called a TSP, a test instances. So these are up to 400 cities. So the number here refers to the number of cities. For subgroup inequalities, we use network flow methods. We can find a subgroup one is violated. So it can optimize with cutting payments, optimize over all the subgroup inequalities. The green points are the ones which subtours alone can produce an optimal tour. So if you optimize over the subtours, you get a TSP towards an optimal solution. The black ones are ones that sadly don't have that. So we optimize over the subgroup problem, but it wasn't good. If we add cones, we get a lot more green ones. Right, so what these green ones mean is that concourse results, the concourse heuristic algorithms, so we don't have exact separation for cones. Concourse cones were not the solver problem. The red ones are the ones where we actually don't know whether they're black or green. So the red ones are like the 76 city problem. It's one where Common Core couldn't find any more cones, but maybe there are some more. Maybe we add some more, we can actually solve the TSP. So the practical implication was we just don't know how strong the common qualities are. But from working with ideas that we were discussing during the URA and combining that with integer programming, we were able to turn the majority of those red ones, unsigned ones, into black ones. Right? So for 10 of the problems, now we're able to prove that that's the best cones can do. So this is the fractional getting of optimality. So they're very close to being optimal towards. This is the objective value for overall cones. But sadly, they don't stop. I said sadly because up to these results, I was hoping that actually maybe cones would even be more powerful, these small examples, than they are. I can't complain about the truth. But for these six ones, we still don't know, because the integer programming problems turn out to be too hard to solve. So using CPEX or Rovi, we sent the problems to the main developers in CPEX and Rovi. Fortunately, actually, I'd say one of them, this one, Daniel Espinosa from Rovi says that he turned this one into black, but I couldn't verify that he had a newer version. All right, so now you understand, in general, what's the cutting edge of it. You solve a linear programming relaxation, find any problems, you're proving them down. So now let me go to the main thing I described in the abstract. So density quotient Johnson solved this 50-city problem. 50 years later, newspapers all around the world report that that's impossible. All right, so what are you going to do about that? I get mad. I was just sort of heartbroken for a while. Because my boys, Danzig, Fox, and Johnson, they're being dished by my journalists all around the world. Alright, so rather than get mad, we said, well, we should get even. So rather than working on a 50-city problem, we, together with Daniel Espinosa, Marcos Cucudier, and heuristic expert Kel Helskin, we put together 50,000 points. So these are historical, there's a registry of historical places in the United States. And this is not a geometric problem. The large geometric problems have been solved. The question is, the research question is, do these type of techniques extend to non-Euclidean problems? So in this case, the distances are given by Google. I wanted it to be symmetric. The distance between A to B is the same as B to A. So these are walking distances from Google, not driving distances. So the total route was 350,000 kilometers to drive. And I find the complexity just marvelous. I mean, you have this local structure of the TSP, but you zoom in, you see the optimizations given by Google. So this is Washington, D.C. I mean, Google's putting you on these little footpaths going right up to the Washington Monument. It's really nice. And this local complexity is something that's missing from those big geometric problems. So this had about 50,000 points. The only larger TSP that's ever been solved has 85,000. This was done together with Applegate, Bixby, and Popcorn 10 years ago. This is a BLSI example. And if you zoom in, you see that, well, you know, if there are points, but there's all these collinear points, probably this is easy among 85,000 city problems. It rose in an application, but probably this is easy. So this was the largest example in the TSP. And indeed, the USA problem is a lot harder to solve than this. So when you're attacking a big problem, we don't work on with cutting planes alone. We combine cutting planes with branch and bound. So cutting planes stop improving the bound very much. What we do is we rip the problem apart. This and reapply linear programming. So the programming based branch and bound through the Elsa lab and Elsa Deutsch. I really like this photograph I received this fall from Elsa Deutsch. This was in a Melbourne newspaper. She just completed an 8 kilometer run. She's 84. It's pretty impressive. The inventor of LP-based branch and bound still running in races. So what it is it's so with the cutting thing, we just keep cutting. For branch and bound, you take a fractional variable, like this one, HE, and you divide the space of two or set of two. Either you use that edge or you don't. So with LP, it's very easy. You just set the variable to zero, you set it equal to one. And you resolve the LP, and necessary, like you get some islands, you reapply the cutting thing method. So that way you get a search tree that eventually solves the problem. So the name of the game is to get small trees. Right? The search tree is obviously going to blow up. So you work as hard as you can to keep the trees small. And that's a good measure of the difficulty of the problem. So for the Gaetan Madison City problem, when we first solved that in 10 years ago, it took us about 1,000 search nodes in the tree. With our current node, it takes 57 nodes. But the USA one takes 800,000. Easily the most difficult problem. Now, I can't go through all the details of how we do this, but I do want to mention one aspect where we have to introduce a new optimization technique. And this actually comes in the data acquisition part. I just said that, well, because at Google, it was a distance between every point and correct points. But what Google wants to do in order to get such a distance between two pairs of points is shot a hard trap, hard shortest path problem for a huge network. So Google actually will give you the distance in a pair of points, but they only value you that 2,500 times a day. And you can sort of teach you the one home and one in office. But the limit number per day. Well, you do a quick calculation, 50,000 squared, it means in your lifetime you're never going to get the matrix. Right? So you somehow have to solve this problem where you can't even query all the data. And yet still solve it exactly. I have to say that you make the assumption that the road distance isn't insured in flying. Because otherwise it's a black box and you have to have to prove everything. But maybe the natural assumption that the distance between two points is no shorter than the Euclidean distance. But given that, you can turn that simple observation, simple statement, into a method. So, for example, the USA problem, suppose you ask Google to tell you the distance to walk from Stanford across the country to Princeton, 2,900 miles. Complicated road. Geometrically, it's very easy to compute, and you get 2,500 miles, so pretty good lower bound on the Google distance. So suppose I solve the USA problem where the only change I make is a single edge. Rather than using Google, I use the geometry. So the problem's identical except for this one piece of data. Solve that problem. If I don't use this edge, then I solve the original problem. Right? Because you're not using that edge in the tour. If you suddenly make it more expensive by going to Google, you're still not going to use it. So that's a simple observation, but it can turn into a full method. So in your linear programming model, rather than using Google distances, I'll just use the geometric distances. Value of LP still is a lower bound for our DSP. And so you design a branch of bound search where periodically you just ask Google for more information. Or you just have to be sure that whenever you report a tour, it really is a tour with real distances. But to improve the bound, you just ask Google for more information. So this refining costs, what I call it, you just treat it the same way as you do branching. The purpose of branching is to increase the bound. The purpose of cutting things is to increase the bound. The purpose of going to Google is to increase the bound. So it's an easy thing to describe, it's a little bit hard to engineer to do this for 50,000 points. But we're able to do that. And we solve that problem by asking Google only for 1.1 million edges. Right? That's a lot, but it's a lot less than 50,000 squared. Along the way, we solved several other problems, the largest of which was some 25,000 pubs in the United Kingdom. This was this one. This was in the Sun, after the map. And I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the many thousands of, not many thousands, but a number of thousands of readers from the UK for sending an email or maybe post on social media explaining that I missed their favorite pub. Because they're right, actually. You know, I looked at the full databases from pubs galore, but I wanted 25,000 cities as a warm-up exercise for the USA one. So what I did is kicked out any pub that didn't sound like a pub. So anything that you know is called TGI Fridays or at a hotel or motel, name it, put out.
What's a Boffin?
What's
a Boffin?
Boffin. That's just I actually was wondering how to use that in one. That's sort of a comment. That's a scientist, a nerd. Unfortunately, this throwing out hotels meant that he threw out pretty much every pub in Scotland. and the Scots, bless their hearts, were courageous enough to be known. But we can listen to our customers. So In February, I went and got the full data set at 50,000 points. That's a much better average of performance. But it's really been a monster to try to solve. Still don't have the solution. What we have is a tour of 63,000 kilometers, but the Olympia tour is 334 meters shorter. This is again a walking tour, so it's going to take you 4 or 5 years, but maybe you can shave off 3 minutes from that. Still something left to do. So why would I care about that little bit? Well, the purpose is not really to design a tour, it's to learn things. And there's things you can learn. Maybe chief among those is how do we manage such a large tree? So the search tree then apparently has nearly 100,000 leaves that I still have to explore. So the question is, should I continue the search or not, or give up? See, these computation goes in waves. When we're doing the searching, I'm finding many more cutting things. The algorithm is getting smarter as it goes along. So at some point, I can say, well, let's go back and start over again. Reapply everything to the root of the tree again. So that, for that reason, it's kind of hard to estimate how close we are to solve. This is something that I'm interested in. All right, but this is, of course, all at the high end. It's like Formula One racing compared to driving on the 401. This is taking enormous computation. This is over several hundred computing years run on these parallel networks. So let me turn to some more practical use of these methods. So let me go back to geometric problems. So I mentioned we saw those root ones meaning to do something non-Euclidean. You go to Euclidean problems, each have 100,000 points. And the cutting plane method, remember there's always money in the cutting plane method. Cutting plane method produces tours that are very close to optimal. I mean, these gaps, these are relative gaps. You might know that if you call an integer programming code like Gorobi, C++. When they report an optimal solution, what they mean is that they've gotten either 4 or 0. So they've gotten better than 1.0001. Yeah. Then they stop. Right? So from their point of view, these LPs are actually done. We've actually solved those problems. Of course, as a TSP for the exact computation, you haven't been solved. But they're very good, which I could say as a triumph. But I have to say that these computations were long and tested. So for that Mona Lisa problem, this was created by Bob Bosch. This took 3 years. I don't mean 3 years in parallel, literally it took 3 years. Because it's a sequential method. You find a solution, cut it off, find a solution, cut it off. It took 3 years to do it. Right? And the only way we saw many LPs fast enough are with the simplex method. And that doesn't parallelize. So this whole thing just runs sequentially, which is bad news. I've been trying to explore ways of getting around that. So rather than cutting them off, I've looked at starting with a best known tour and blowing out cloud points around it and cutting those all in parallel. Which worked well, but I wanted to try a more simple method that also works well. So the whole idea of linear programming is use these little local rules and combine them with a simplex method into a global statement. So why not look for cutting lanes just locally? So let's partition the space. Of course, no matter how I partition, I want cutting planes that go across the region, so I also look across region borders. So it's all together 49 borders. I'll independently run the cutting plane in each one of those regions, gather all the cuts together into one big LP. I only have one LP, so I don't need to use the syntax method. I use an interior group of variables, because that parallelizes. Doing all that for that Mona Lisa problem in 3 months. So 3 minutes, we got below the optimality for an integer programming solver. This is a 100,000 city TSP. 3 minutes we have a bound that has better than a commercial solver stock. These other ones are not quite, but still quite good. And we improve those a little bit by taking bigger regions or looking harder within the regions. But I have to say that this is sort of a one-shot metric. Either you're happy with these results or you're not. If you already have a really good LP, this type of decomposition doesn't really help you too much. But even there, we can do something. In order to describe it, I want to give a geometric interpretation of the LP solution. This is the dual LP solution for separate inequalities. These disks for the dual variables corresponding to those equations. So it says that any graph across a disk is actually false. These moats are called these yellow regions. Every tour has a separate inequality. Everyone has to cross these points. So we sum the width of all those objects is the lower bound. So what we're going to do is try to prove that. Focus in on a region, and we'll try to repack just within that region. And we'll move that window around in parallel and eventually get a pretty good solution. So this was done with David Applegate from networks at Google and Kel Hellstrom. So for a problem consisting of a million points on Earth, so a little over a million points, is every the OpenStreetMap project, this is every piece of data down to the village level. So a little over a million of them. The distances are not driving or walking, they're the geodesic distances. For that, we have a tour and an LP that give us, well, not quite that optimality, but a qualified factor too. So quite good. And still hoping for more. This again, though, it's not Euclidean, but it's, you know, the sphere and the plane are pretty much the same thing. Right, so this is like a Euclidean problem. The road distances are non-Euclidean, but they're two-dimensional. And again, made use of very thin air to have it. So to finish up, I want to go back to the thing I started off with three-dimensional data. That's clearly non-plane. Let's see what we can do there. So the next three-dimensional data is the points of stars, and in fact, there are. It's a database of some 119,000 stars that has three-dimensional position. Started working on it in around February. And surprising to me, we just this September, we actually finished it. This is now the largest traveling sales problem that's ever been solved. That's 119,000 points, where the distance is the Euclidean distance. And so it's not working. And you can see that it's actually a technique easier than the road problem. The only actual difficulty was that this has a weird data set, a weird quirk. See, all these points are up here, and then there's a score. So this is 10,000 points on this big sphere, and there's 109,000 inside of there. So when I don't tend to look at data while I'm trying to solve this. I'm trying to solve general purpose methods. But then whenever I saw it, I examined it in detail. What happened is there are 10,000 points where the astronomy information doesn't give you enough to tell how far away it is. So we know where it is in the sky, we just don't know how far away it is. So they put those 10,000 points on a sphere radius 100,000 parsecs. And all the real data is within 1,000 parsecs. Right? So you really have this habit for the curve. It makes it sound easy, but the fact that it made it more difficult. But it makes sense that we worked again on those inner points, solve that one. So, and again, this is larger than any other problem that I've ever solved. And some of these three-dimensional problems, I would have guessed are more difficult, but for LP methods, they seem to be somewhat easier for two-dimensional. I don't understand why. I know the LP solves are going faster, but that's not the observation. What's nice about computation, we can do this all the time, right? It's a weaker problem. This has 250,000 closest stars in the big database. For these ones, we've only been working on this about a month. We have a tour and an LP that are within 14 parsecs. I'm really happy with those bounds, except for the whole Han Solo Kessel run there.
114 parsecs?
12!
Yeah, 12. 14, 14 is for losers. Yeah, well, first, you know, we saw branching cut. This is the branching bound. This is the largest instance that we ever tried to do branching bound on. But in fact, pushes the gap down below, called parsecs. I think so. This 150,000 is actually just a small part of a much larger database that's called the Gaia database from the European Space Agency. And they had enough information there that a team in Max Planck Institute in Germany was able to give three-dimensional positioning for over 2 million stars. So then we applied with Applegate and Hellstrom our decomposition approaches. And here, we have a tour of 28.8 million parsecs and off by 823. Right, so that now that has the lovely port music there. But this is 3 times better than the commercial solvers of this type. This is a 2 million city problem. I mean, all this is driven by linear programming and the cutting-edge method. So that's what I try to emphasize, the cutting-edge method. Now, I'm guessing because I have to give a similar talk in January. There's a movie called Big Lebowski. This is a big scene in Big Lebowski. If you ever watch Big Lebowski, you see this. Okay, sorry. The kind of thing that what I mean is that
this is driving all this work, and yet it has almost no theoretical results to back it up, no asymptotic results.
So we have examples that show that even for modest, you know, examples that require exponential amount of rounds of cutting plans. Not only that, each step in the cutting plan method, the only way to do it in practice is with the simplex algorithm, and that's an exponential time algorithm. Right, so you're using exponentially many steps, each step takes exponential time. So certainly it's like a nightmare for us or something working out. And yet, that's what we use. And if you go back to the original Danzig, Close, and Johnson, not the paper that appeared in the journal, but their technical version of it, they know that there are many theoretical difficulties. But in their plain spoken English, if you would like it, they just say, well, works so far. And indeed, that's pretty much all I can say at this point, that it doesn't work so well. Right? I mean, we saw huge instances of the traveling salesman problem and many other discrete optimization problems that are not solvable by any other techniques. Most important of these in practice is the mixed integer programming. So when I talk 255, I always say that's where the big bugs are. So Bixby, who is my co-author, focuses on the LP integer programming side, and he's got an understanding about that. And then just this last month in the inference meeting in Houston, he had this slide that he presented. And he said year by year improvements in mixed integer programming software. First, CPLEX was his code, he wrote CPLEX, and then he was part of Heroku, he part of Heroku. So has this year by year improvement. So it's nearly a factor of two every year. So since 1990, the code has gotten 1.9 million times faster. And this is hardware independent. This is just the algorithm, 1.9 million times faster. So if you take a hardware improvement, it's well over a billion times faster. Right, so the problems that used to take forever now just take seconds. So these improvements very much that are driven by ideas that come from the TSP in general, but the cutting plan method in particular. You really do have at the TSP exercise. So the main takeaway that if you're faced with an NP-hard problem that you really need to solve, or at least come really, really close to quickly solving it, well, don't just give up and say, well, NP-hard, we learned that you can't do that. I'm hoping that I try to convince you that that's not necessary. I like this Scotty in the back. There's something called an outside context problem. So the example gives where it's something that makes you die. If you're good at TSP, it's one of those type of problems, right? Or any type of NP-hard problem. So roll up your sleeves, apply the cutting plan method, some type of search method, and see what you can do. So what I like to do is in the scene, so I grew up around New York and New Jersey, so we identify with anything in life within the science of it. So I'd like you to identify Elaine Venice with the cutting plan method and you have a conversation with Frank Costanza as an NPR problem.
I never
heard of that. How the hell does that mean?
That means whatever the hell you want it to be.
You're saying you want a piece of me?
I drop you like a bag of dirt.
You want a piece of me? You got it!
Yeah, that's what you do. If you face an NPR problem, you say you want a piece of me? Let me say, go back to one thing maybe that you might be worried about. That you might be concerned I'm cluttering up Cypress paper. I threw out all those balls and you see those balls are still there. But, as you know, that I took the time to program the Yondu's algorithm. So what it'll do is going to fly through in the shortest possible way and pop all those balloons. Clean up everything when you're done. Okay, thanks.
Is there any questions for Professor Cook?
Yeah, I didn't understand the first thing. So then
how does the branch and bounds compare?
it's good to have about 25 in the program. On the other hand, this is a branch of Malloc, and when you give me a 1,000-city problem, the dynamic programming has zero chance of solving it. Whereas the branch of Malloc, when you have good memories, you do have a chance. So, the worst case, dynamic programming is the only game of that. But and in practice, you want to combine branch of Malloc.
Where did the idea come from that you couldn't solve the 48 or 49 city fastest? Like, presumably,
So it happened very quickly. So he did this for Discover magazine, and there was this article. But the next day, Washington Post had something called "Data Genius Solves Impossible Problems." And then once the Washington Post put that out, then suddenly within 2 weeks he was on National Public Radio, which on Saturday with an interview. And so I had at that time I already had that small PSD book that I wrote, and so I contacted the publisher. They sent out to the newspaper saying that I actually found it was very easy. It took like a minute on my phone, or less than a few seconds on my phone, to solve a real tour. So I offered $10,000, and they were saying the real tour was impossible. So I said, offer $10,000, anyone find short tour than that? But the journalists didn't care, they moved on. So then it was a success. They published an article, it's got 100,000 likes. Success. The only one, I have to say, the only one that responded was Nate Silver. There are 31 that responded to that request. So for most of the journalists, this was a success. Right. And so I asked a specific math writer, Alex Bedos, who I really like from The Guardian, and he said that, you know, these people are really rushed for time. You know, they
so the gap, like the
one
point
three
billion or whatever, that is how close to the output?
Yeah, that's it. If you take the tour divided by the band.
How do you know that number without actually finding the
optimal? Yeah, so I don't know the optimal, but I have a tour, and I know its length. And I have a bound, a linear program.
Yeah.
So I don't know, I suspect, for a really big problem, I don't know what it is. So either the tour is wrong or a bound is wrong, and they don't know.
Right.
Presumably both of them are wrong. For the smaller ones, like for that UK problem, I think the tour is probably optimal. Yeah, I tried to contact somebody. So there was a famous computer scientist, David Johnson. You might know the entry partner, Darren Johnson. So he had a course on the TSP at Columbia about 3 years ago. And he had a student, because I know they were asking me about Common Core, how to change Common Core to work on higher dimensions. They went up to dimension 7. And once you got up to quite high dimensions, like 7, the problem did seem to be easier. But he unfortunately died. And it wasn't old, but people died. I tried to write to a student, but he works for Business Now, so I don't know the results. But I remember that I still see David Johnson's slide online, and he says this, but the chart attacks his mission. But yeah, it's a good question whether you get up to dimension 100, does it get steadily easier? They presented some theoretical question on cutting planes, and Paul thought I were able to solve it in a few days. But then later in the meeting, they presented, Matt Ricciardo presented his computational results, and said, "Oh, this is back, we got into the game." So then I then thought, "Oh, we can do this. How hard can it be?" So we thought we got David out to be on our team. It's super programming, so we'll just take a few months, and then it'll take like 20 years or so. So not here, we're here in the beginning. So I'm teaching a course in we like this type of stuff. I'm teaching a course generally about this type of computational work, but trying to take a viewpoint of whether deep learning techniques can be applied to this type of scenario. But that's a topic that the course I'm teaching. So we're used to taking sort of the advanced sections of courses to quite capable.